Dear friends, welcome in IGNU and National Board of Examination joint efforts of this live tele-interaction session. Here we are today going to discuss in long case of radiology, and for that we are having experts and also representative of National Board of Examination. Just next to me he is Dr. Anurag Agarwal. He is a assistant controller Controller of Examination of National Board of Examination, and he is looking after all the other activities also. And next to Dr. Anurag is Dr. Bijender Kumar, Bijender Nath Tripathi, and he is basically a DNB candidate. He is doing his radiology, and today he will be presenting the case. Next to him is Dr. Nitin R. Parekh. He is a HOD radiology in Stephen's Hospital, and he will initiate and taking part in the discussion of this today's long case discussion. And extremely left, he is Dr. Rajiv Sethi. He is a senior consultant in radiology in St. Stephen's Hospital. So dear friends, all of you know very well that radiology is the one of the component which evolved in medical education and medical treatment as well as healthcare. In a such way that today even none of us we can imagine anything beside this radiology. Wherever you go, first they will ask for chest x-ray or ultrasound or many other radiological techniques. So dear friends, it is very much necessary that to know the basic fundamentals, how it's work, how it's really help to our diagnosis and as well as treatment of the patient, how it's really help us for the better healthcare facility. So all of things today we are having very good experts over here, and they will discuss. So I would like to hear tell something about this today's case discussion to Dr. Anurag Agarwal, please.
Good morning, friends and colleagues. In DNB final examination of radiology, the long case carries the maximum marks, and it is very important for the candidate to present it in a proper way and in a confident manner. So I request Dr. Sethi to begin with the proceedings of the long case.
Good morning to all of you. I am presenting case number one, which is a long case. How do you get this? This is a history, sir. How did this come there?
Enlarge that to the symbol below.
Case 1, a 45 years old woman with history of chest pain and dyspnea with normal ECG referred from the medicine department for further workup. I am giving the first slide.
Go to the next case.
This was a chest x-ray which was referred from the department of medicine to radiology. So kindly interpret the skygram, please.
This is a PA view, chest PA view. The bilateral lung fields appears normal. About the contour of the heart, the upper the right border of the heart appears normal. The dome of the diaphragms appears normal. The left border appears in a proper contour. There is a opacity, a vascular opacity, which is seen on the prominent vascular opacity, which is seen on the right side of the hilum. And otherwise, the bony chest cavity, the clavicles, the imaged part of the clavicle and the ribs appears grossly unremarkable. So on this chest X-ray, besides all the findings, we are seeing that there is a prominent vascular shadow on the right half of the chest.
Now what I want to lay emphasis on is, whenever you see a chest X-ray, whenever you see a chest X-ray, you go in a systematic order, either from outside inside, from inside outside. You should always see for the trachea, the central airway. You never comment on the trachea. You should always see the either you go from the central airway into the parenchyma or from outside outside. Otherwise, you look for the ABCDE. Look for the airway. Look for the bones. Look for the calcifications. For the diaphragm densities. So here, similarly, if you see here, what you said was, it's a PA view, and you said there's prominence of the right hilum. Can I have a cursor here, please? How do you go back, sir?
Page up.
How do you go back? How do you go back?
Page up and
right click. Go to previous. No, right click. Go to previous slide.
Yeah. Now, if you see the skygram, can I have a skygram slide, please? If you see the conventional skygram, you said there's prominence of the right hilum. When do you say there's prominence of the pulmonary artery? What are the criteria?
So the pulmonary artery shadow becomes more visual. We can see if the density of the pulmonary artery is increased, or if we can see that the diameter of the pulmonary artery is more.
So according to you,
we have to compare it with the adjacent shadow of the airways.
Okay. Now, if you are saying that pulmonary, you said there is increased density in the pulmonary artery. Now, when you say there is an increased density in the pulmonary artery, what are you trying to imply on?
Sir, this could be a pathology. There could be a pathology which is related to the pulmonary vasculature. Like there could be increased density could be because of some obstruction in the pulmonary artery level, or maybe some other shadows which are overlapping with that region. Like sometimes even a soft tissue shadow, lymph node shadow sitting just at the level of pulmonary artery can give a prominence in the pulmonary artery. Okay. On a radiograph.
Now, whenever you have a pulmonary artery, increased density in the pulmonary artery, you should always see for the cardiac profile, because dynamic changes of the pulmonary the inflow of the into the pulmonary arteries from the right ventricle.
Yes, sir.
So whenever you have obstruction in the pulmonary artery, you should always see for the cardiac. Now, if you have any obstruction in the pulmonary artery, you look at the cardiac margins, cardiac profile. Are they normal or abnormal?
So in this given skygram, the CT ratio appears to be within normal limit. Plus the right border of the heart also appears slightly bulging, but appears to be within normal limit.
When do you say right heart border is slightly bulging? What do you mean by bulging of right heart border?
So mainly in the right heart border is mainly compromised of right atrium most of the time, and then the base is formed by the right ventricle. Now, whenever there is some pathology which leads to the enlargement of the right atrium, it will lead to the increased bulge in the right atrial level. Like the border will not be straight.
You will not see. You will see an increased bulge in the right heart border. You mean to say that? Will the pathology of the right atrium affect the pulmonary artery?
Yes.
Will it or no?
Sir, it will be reflected. The pathology of the right
The pathology of a pulmonary right atrium generally is affected onto the venous
pathology.
That is the SVC or the IVC. You will see back pressure changes. Whenever you see a spurious opacity in the pulmonary artery, always see for the first the adjoining structures. The point is whether you should see the surrounding structures, whether there is a coastal cartilage calcification which is mimicking a spurious density in the pulmonary artery, or is it a lymph node there, or is a parenchymal pathology. You see for the normal structures initially.
Yeah, now, actually, sorry for interruption. I just would like to know, what is the basically CT ratio? You said CT ratio appeared to be normal. What is it and how you really define it? I think our viewers would like to know what is CT ratio.
The cardiac thoracic ratio, normally cardiac thoracic ratio. Can I have the skygram slide, please? The chest skygram slide, please. Normally, the cardiac thoracic ratio in adult is, you take the maximum outer diameter of the right heart border and the maximum concavity of the left heart border. you take an entire transverse diameter from the maximum convexity of the right heart border and the left heart border. The maximum dimension is the transverse diameter.
So the line may not be necessary it is horizontal, it may be oblique also.
No, generally it can be, but you have to take the maximum convexity border.
No, in this trichrome actually this it is not coming in a horizontal line, it is coming
it has to
oblique.
Be measured as a horizontal line.
And then just above the, where is the widest card thoracic transverse diameter? The widest thoracic transverse diameter generally at the basal margins, you draw a horizontal line there. This ratio should be 1:2. If this is 100, the transverse thoracic diameter is 100, the cardiac diameter should be 50. 1:2. If it is more than 1/2, if this is 100, the transverse diameter of the thorax is 100, and the cardiac transverse diameter is 60, that is more than half, it is cardiomegaly. It's an indirect evidence of cardiomegaly. Generally in the exams, the candidates sometimes do not carry a ruler. So arbitrarily you can also suggest cardiomegaly. The maximum bulge of the right heart border from the spine, you see a spine midline?
Yes.
You draw a perpendicular from the spine to the maximum transverse maximum convex concavity of the right heart border. This distance from the spine to the maximum concavity should not exceed the image portion of the left transverse the left lower lung parenchyma. Got my point?
Yeah.
If this distance from the midline of the spine to the concavity of the right heart border exceeds the left transverse diameter of the left thoracic cage, it implies indirect evidence of cardiomegaly. It's indirect evidence. If you don't have a ruler or measurements, you can just apply this arbitrarily and say it is cardiomegaly.
May I add that these measurements are always taken on a chest X-ray in full inspiration. So if you don't have that full inspiratory film, then you'll get an abnormal reading. So occasionally you have a chest X-ray taken in expiration and you'd get a false reading. So you make sure that this X-ray is done in full inspiration, then take the measurements. Then you'd be accurate.
Should cardiomegaly be commented upon a supine X-ray?
No, sir.
Only an erect PA.
Right. Sir, like you told me, it should be taken as a full inspiration position. So, what are the other precautions a person should take during the taking of the skygram regarding the chest X-ray?
The positioning would have to be very accurate.
Yes, sir.
And the inspiration, like I said,
what,
has to be a full.
What do you mean by positioning? Is there any specific position of arm or any position
yes.
seen? Would you like to mention, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, go ahead. What sir said, Dr. Nitin, our head of the department, what he said was exactly right. The skygram should be taken in full inspiration. How do you say a full inspired skygram? How does a radiologist come to know whether the chest X-ray is taken in full inspiration? There are certain criteria which have been given in literature. Either you count the interior ribs or you count the posterior ribs. If you find more than 6 interior ribs, if you are able to image more than 6 interior ribs, it is generally taken into consideration, the skygrams have been taken in full inspiration. Now I am counting the ribs for you. That is the first interior rib, the second interior rib, the third interior rib, the fourth, the fifth and the sixth. You can see the seventh. So generally this skygram you generally take is taken in a full inspiration. That is the indirect way to say it is a inspired chest X-ray film. If you are not able to see more than 6 interior ribs or more than 8 to 10 posterior ribs, then it is could be the patient, the patient has either not breathed fully or the radiologist has taken the skygram in mid-inspiration. The patient might have been inspiring and in doing mid-inspiration the skygram has been taken. This results in a false magnification. As a result, we get a spurious cardiomegaly. It is not a true cardiomegaly, we get a spurious cardiomegaly. So that is a limitation on portable skygrams, in which is the AP view, in which you have spurious cardiomegaly. So there we cannot say cardiomegaly with certainty. We can say apparent cardiomegaly. Though the patient may be having cardiomegaly, but on skygrams we cannot say cardiomegaly with certainty because it gives a spurious magnification.
Thank you.
Yes, can I have this skygram one, please? Now, what I told you, you said you are seeing added density in the pulmonary artery. If you are seeing an added density in the pulmonary artery, now this added density, is it in the lumen of the pulmonary artery or is it in the wall of the pulmonary artery or is it extravascular? Can you comment on that, please?
So for commenting whether the density, the added density, is within the lumen or it's outside the lumen, we have to trace the margin of the pulmonary artery. Like by tracing the margin, and if we are seeing that the density is outside the margin of the pulmonary artery, we can judge that this is an extraluminal.
Okay. Now, can I have this diagram one, please? Now, if you see here, you are saying you. No, you are seeing here, you said you trace the margin of the pulmonary artery. I'm tracing the margin of the pulmonary artery. I'm tracing the margin of the pulmonary artery. You mean, to, according to you, say this opacity is within the lumen of the pulmonary artery?
It appears to be.
So if it is in the lumen of the pulmonary artery, what is the, then it should cause increase in the size of the pulmonary artery or no?
So if it is within the pulmonary artery, this opacity could lead to the increase in the size of
so
the
So what is the normal size of the right descending pulmonary artery?
The normal size is 5 mm on a chest x-ray.
Normally the right descending pulmonary artery in males is 16 mm. You take these measurements, you take the measurement, you, this is the right descending pulmonary artery, you measure this. It is 16 mm in males and 15 to 14 mm in females. If you are able to see more than 16 mm dimensions of the pulmonary artery, it is indication of a pulmonary arterial pathology like pulmonary arterial hypertension. Whenever you have an obstruction within the lumen of any viscus or any vessel, you will always see pre-obstruction dilatation or post-obstruction dilatation. Now if you say this is within the lumen of the vessel, you are saying this is within the lumen of the vessel. Is there any dilatation pre-obstruction or post-obstruction? Is the narrowing? Something is there in the lumen. You will have obviously a slight amount of water, the blood is gushing out into the pulmonary artery from the right ventricle with great pressure. And if there is obstruction in the pulmonary artery, distally, there should be proximal dilatation. So is there any proximal dilatation there? Is there or not there?
So in this diagram, the apparent dilatation is seen, sir, proximal to that.
Okay, apparent dilatation. What forms the hilum?
The hilum is formed by the pulmonary vasculatures mainly, and then there is lymph nodes and the.
No, this is a one common interpretation miss generally by the radiology undergraduate students in medicine or the radiology first year residents. Whenever they asked what forms the hilum, they say lymph nodes. But lymph nodes are not the constituents of the hilum. The normal structures which form the hilum are the pulmonary vasculature only. The hilum is formed by the pulmonary vasculature. Lymph nodes are the pathological entity in the hilum. It is not a normal entity of the hilum. So it is a, if you see here, you are just seeing a right descending pulmonary artery with a spurious density there. Can you comment on anything on the lung parenchyma, please?
Yeah, I was about to say that. I think Dr. Brijendra, when you commented in the initial thing, that you said that the lung fields were normal. But I think just be careful when you comment on things like that. But once simultaneously you commented about the pulmonary artery being abnormal. So I think there has to be some abnormality in the lung fields. And now retrospectively, can you correlate the two signs? Dilated pulmonary artery with an opacity. Now have a look at the lung fields and see whether the right and the left lung fields correlate to that finding. Let's go back to the skygram, please. Thank you.
On retrospectively, when we have noticed that there is some added density in the pulmonary vasculature, now the main thing is we have to compare the lung fields, the distal to that pulmonary vasculature, with the on the opposite sides. And now retrospectively, we can see that there is the vascular densities are appears to be less properly seen on the right side compared to the left, the vascular markings.
Good.
So there is a localized oligemia which can be apparent on that we can say that there is some amount of decreased vascular shadows in lower zone of the right lung field.
Okay. Whenever you see a chest diagram, whenever you see a lung pathology, what are the common entities which come into your mind?
So whenever we are seeing a skygram, we have to say about the whether the translucency has been increased or there we are seeing a density in that region.
Okay.
So by that we come to a lot of differentials. Like air entry has been increased in there or the air entry has been decreased, like the air
forget the differentials at present. Normally, what are the normal pathological entities you generally see in a lung parenchyma?
The lung parenchyma,
like we see a collapse, we see a consolidation. Now, what are other things you can see in a lung parenchyma?
We can even see the bulle formation, or we can see vascular pathologies like decreased blood supply to a particular region. The infarction can be seen.
Can you go back, please? Normally, whenever you see a chest X-ray, always look supraclavicular, infraclavicular, hilar, perihilar. The right pericardic regions, the left pericardic regions, the supra-diaphragmatic levels, the coastal margins, the lateral chest walls. Now, if you have several approaches in your mind, pathology entities become very easy to pick up. You look for the collapse, consolidations. Whenever you see a collapse, the collapse could be either a totally homogeneous opacity, it could be a sub-segmental opacity, it could be a linear opacity. Alright? Or consolidations. You can see again infiltrative opacity. You can see a mass in the lung. You can see a pleural pathology in the lung. You can see a diaphragmatic pathology in the lung. You can see a retrocardiac pathology. Now, out of this, can you see any form of collapse in the lungs, please? In right or left lung, can you comment on anything of the collapse, please? Is there any direct evidence of collapse in any of the lung fields?
So the direct evidence for a collapse, we have to see whether there is volume loss or not.
Okay.
If we can see a direct density or shadow, like a collapse segment appears as a dense opaque region in the lung fields. In this case, there is elevation of the diaphragm, right dome of diaphragm, but it is normally also we usually see elevated right dome of the diaphragm.
When do you say there is elevation of the right dome of diaphragm?
So whenever on comparison with the left dome of diaphragm, if it is more than 3 cm, we say it is...
No, arbitrarily you think this is more than 3 cm?
No, it's not.
So why did you say there is elevation of the right diaphragm? So whenever you say something, you should just pause for a minute or enough for a second and think retrospectively. Now, go above the supra-diaphragmatic levels. Go above the supra-diaphragmatic levels.
So there is where the cursor is, we can see there is a opacity, a homogeneous type of opacity seen in the inferior zone of the lower zone of the right lung field, slightly peripherally placed.
Okay. You see, there is a linear. Can you see there is one accentuated linear opacity in this diagram, where my cursor is?
Yes, sir.
It's standing out. It's a very accentuated linear opacity there. So when this is a linear opacity. No, when do you get linear opacity in the lung? What do you mean linear opacity? Which type of pathology can cause a well-defined linear opacity in the lung? Can a consolidation be well-defined?
No, consolidation cannot be well-defined.
Unless it has been abutted by fissure.
Fissures.
Whenever there is a fissure, then a consolidation will have one margin will be well-defined. Otherwise, consolidation will never be well-defined. Now you see, which other pathology can have a linear well-defined entity in the lung?
Sir, so sometimes a plate atelectasis.
Very good. So this is a sub-segmental plate atelectasis. Now, again correlate your entire pathology picture and now come to the conclusion. You have a plate atelectasis here. You have a suspicious of a density in the right pulmonary artery with very marginal subjective loss of viscosity in the right lung field. So what do you think this could be?
Sir, seeing all the picture in totality, there it goes towards a pathology where there could be obstruction in the pulmonary artery level. So the main diagnosis at this juncture could be
You should never say a main diagnosis. It should be a differential diagnosis.
Type of obstruction in the pulmonary vasculature. Could be a thrombus or could be...
Okay. What else will you like to do next for confirming whether it is a pathology? What else investigation will you like to do?
So to confirm the next could be a lateral X-ray, just to see whether the exact.
Okay. apart from the conventional sky gauze, what else you like to do?
The next main investigation will be a CT scan, sir.
A CT scan. Okay. before I go to the CT scan, just for repetition, I would like to comment. Whenever you see a skygram, you should always start going from the airway into the parenchyma. So look for the central airway, the trachea, the carina, the right and left mainstem bronchus. Whenever you come into the trachea, look at the paratracheal stripe, because paratracheal stripe, generally lot of entities, pathologies involve the paratracheal stripe. So always pay attention to the paratracheal margins. Follow that by go to the lung parenchyma, look at the supraclavicular, the infraclavicular, the perihilar, the right pericardiac, the supradiaphragmatic, the left lower zone. Otherwise, the how the students describe it, upper zone, mid zone, lower zone. Upper zone is from first to anterior intercostal spaces, mid zone is from the second to fourth anterior intercostal spaces, and the lower zone is from the fourth to the remaining intercostal spaces. Whenever you then look at the cardiac, whenever you see at the cardiac, apart from the cardiac size ratio, always pay attention to the retrocardiac region, because certain pathologies lie in the retrocardiac region, which you always should pay attention at. And then look at the bony cage, and last but not the least, always look at the infradiaphragmatic levels. This is a red herring for the radiologist. Sometimes the radiologist is in a quick hurry, or a confident radiologist who is over enthusiastic does not look at the infradiaphragmatic regions. Infradiaphragmatic regions say a lot of things on chest X-ray. Like whenever you should always pay attention to funding gastric bubble. If you are not able to see the funding gastric bubble, always keep a pathology of a esophageal or a gastric pathology in mind. And secondly, you should always look at the distance of the funding gastric bubble from the diaphragmatic leaflet. This distance should be not 0.5 millimeters. If this distance is more than 0.5 millimeters, it means there is some element of subdiaphragmatic pathology. There could be subdiaphragmatic effusion, subdiaphragmatic collections. Alright? So we like to go to the next slide, please.
I would like to comment on one thing, that a student should never make a mistake in saying whether the X-ray is a PA view or AP view, because this is something which can cause very bad impression on the examiner. If a mistake is made whether the X-ray is a AP view or PA view, or if they are not aware of the positioning of a chest X-ray or the factors of a chest X-ray, then it becomes very difficult for a student to make up for this mistake.
Then again, the next question is arise, like how a student will identify whether a chest view is a PA view or AP view.
Yes. Can I have the skygram slide, please? There's a lot of signs which have been described in the literature regarding AP and PA view, but the practical signs which are very important is look at the clavicles. The medial end of the clavicle will be always slanting down in an APA view. In an AP view, the medial end of the clavicle will be laterally positioned. If you see here, the medial end of the clavicle is slanting down. So this is generally one of the practical signs of a PA view. Secondly, you see the ribs are more vertically oriented, not vertically, obliquely oriented. Obliquely oriented. The ribs, when the anterior is obliquely oriented, it goes again in favor of a PA view. In a PA view, you will always see a funding gastric bubble in a rect view. In AP view, it's very unlikely to see a funding gastric bubble. Air fluid levels are generally seen in a rect view and in a PA view. There will be no apparent cardiomegaly. If you see here, there is no apparent cardiomegaly. If the patient does not have any cardiac pathology, he will not have cardiomegaly. But if your patient has no cardiac pathology, but you are seeing cardiomegaly, it is generally more commonly seen in a PA view, AP view, as a superior entity. It's apparent cardiomegaly. It's not a true cardiomegaly, because there is apparent magnification in an AP view, but there is no magnification, which is a physics involved in taking of the skygram. There is no magnification in a PA view, but there is magnification in the AP view, which causes apparent enlargement of the medicinal structure that is cardiomegaly. Finally, you see the scapula. The scapula do not lie in the lung parenchyma in the PA view, but in AP view, they overlap the lung parenchyma. So the scapula lying outside the lung parenchyma in a PA view. If they are overlapping the lung parenchyma, you see upper zone, mid zone, or the supra in the infraclavicular region, you are not seeing the lung, but you are seeing the scapula. That means it is done like to be a AP film.
Can I add two more findings to that? Yes. One is, again, the clavicle. By the very nature of doing the PA view, you're pulling your shoulders forward to touch the film, and so that makes the clavicles S-shaped. So on a PA view, your clavicles are S-shaped, while on an AP view, the clavicles become straight. There is another sign which is not so well described or not commonly described, but also seen in the upper dorsal vertebrae. The spinous processes on a PA view appear biconvex or like a namaste, like a hands namaste sign, something like that would be the appearance of the upper dorsal spinous processes. So if you see those again, S-shaped clavicles on a PA, namaste sign of spinous processes on a PA, but straight clavicles on a AP view. Yeah.
Can I have the next slide, please?
You have to click.
Before I go to the CT scan, I'm showing you the blow-up image of the previous diagram, which is a zoomed-up image of that linear opacity which we saw
in the previous.
The linear opacity which we are seeing here, I'm showing you the blow-up image of that zoomed-up image. Can you see now clearly the linear opacity then?
Yes, sir.
So that is your pre-tetral thesis.
Can I just add a little on plate atelectasis? What is the fundamental behind a plate atelectasis? The idea behind it is that there is always poor inspiratory effort. So you would commonly see this kind of a finding in postoperative cases where they've had abdominal surgery, cannot breathe deeply because of the pain. They are likely to get plate atelectasis, or patients who are sedentary, not enough activity in those kind of patients who are not breathing deeply. So always remember that that if you have a person who does not have enough respiratory effort, then you're going to develop plate atelectasis. So then you start thinking of causes that would cause a decreased respiratory effort. That can sometimes lead you to the diagnosis itself.
Now this is the limit. I'm showing you only the pathological entities of the CT scans, the limited cuts. Now can you interpret on this limited cut of this CT scan?
So this is the cross-section imaging taken at the level of the bifurcation. We can, in this, if we go, as you had said, in the systematic way about the bifurcation, we are seeing the bifurcation of the hilum. We are seeing the right mainstem bronchus and the left mainstem bronchus. Adjacent to that, bifurcating the main right mainstem bronchus is bifurcating into the upper and lower segmental bronchi. Also, the bilateral lung fields are observed. Then the vascular shadows, we are seeing the part of the ascending aorta, the descending aorta, cut section of the descending aorta. We are seeing the main pulmonary trunk and also the opacity, which are the vascular field. The density is the contrast media is seen, so they are the vascular channels. And then the other shadow which is surrounding this vasculature is mainly the fat content which is surrounding them.
So whenever you see any cross-sectional anatomy of any part of the scan of the body, always first see which window it is. Now if you see, this is a section of the thorax or which has been taken just subcranial or at the cranial level, it is a lung window. And whenever you see a lung window, you should always describe the airway, wherever the lung airway is there, it's an airway window. Wherever there is lung or the airway, you should describe the identity. The medicinal entity is seen in a medicinal window. So if you see, you are seeing a lung window here at the cranial level. Now if you see here, you are seeing that Can you comment on the lung parenchyma?
So in the lung window, in the compared with the left lung fields, we are seeing that there is a decreased vascular opacities or the vascular densities on the right side. The right peripheral region in the right mid peripheral parts are showing decreased vascular densities compared to the left side.
Yeah. So there, all what you say, there's hyperattenuation of the lung vascular markings or decreased lung vascular markings in the right lung field as compared to the contralateral left lung field. So there is oligemic lung fields. So whenever you have a oligemic lung fields, what do you like to see next?
Then we would like to see the mediastinal window.
Very good. We would like to see the mediastinal window to see for the pulmonary vascularity, how the blood vessel is flowing through the blood flow is to the lung in the lung fields. So this is your pulmonary vascularity. Now, can you comment on this, please?
Now, this is a cross-sectional CT scan image which is showing the mediastinal window. In this, the mediastinal structures which are seen is the mainly the part of the ascending aorta, the descending aorta. Then we are seeing the main pulmonary trunk and its branch, that the right pulmonary artery. Also, we are seeing the left pulmonary artery. Now, once we try to trace the left, the right pulmonary artery, we are seeing the contrast is not properly opacifying the right pulmonary artery, and distally there is a hypodense pathology within the lumen of the right pulmonary artery.
So this is a cross sectional, this is a mediastinal window section which is taken at the level of the supracardiac level. Okay, this is supracardiac level. You are just starting to, the cardiac chambers are just starting to appear. So here this is your main pulmonary trunk, that's the right descending pulmonary artery, that is your ascending aorta, that's your descending aorta. That is a portion of the SVC. This is SVC. Now you are seeing an interluminal filling defect. You should never see a pathology. You should describe an interluminal filling defect is seen in an opacified, homogeneously opacified pulmonary artery. The proximal, the distal part or the proximal part of the pulmonary artery is showing an interluminal filling defect. Can you see that? Interluminal
filling
defect, which is also partly seen in the descending, left descending pulmonary artery. So, taking the previous picture into mind, oligemic lung fields, and with interluminal field defects in the pulmonary arteries, what do you think it could be?
Sir, this goes more in favor of a thrombus within the pulmonary artery, so it is a case of pulmonary embolism.
It is a case of pulmonary
embolism.
So you say most likely my differential could be a interluminal vascular pathology contributing to oligomy lung fields, which is resulting in a pulmonary embolism, which could be which may or may not be attributed to pulmonary embolism. It could be just a pulmonary clot also there.
Sir.
It could be a pulmonary thrombus also. So you should never be dogmatic to say a diagnosis. You say this is an intravascular pathology, could be a thrombus or a clot. So what else you like to see if you are thinking of a case of a pulmonary embolism?
So in a case of pulmonary thromboembolism, the next investigation which will help us to give a diagnosis is the VQ scan, the ventilation perfusion scan.
Okay, that is a confirmatory. Or as a radiologist, you are in the CT scan room, you are doing this study. Will you like to do something more for confirmation of your assumed diagnosis of pulmonary embolism?
What is the origin of this clot or filling?
Very good. Yeah. You like to see for the origin of the clot. So what do you like to do?
So the most common cause for the pulmonary thromboembolism is a clot which is coming from the deep veins.
Okay.
So in this situation, we would like to see the patient in totality, and we would like to find out whether the patient is having pedal edema or swellings, where we can do a Doppler to find out whether there is
The patient is on the table. You don't have the time to take the patient on the Doppler. On the gantry table of the CT scan, we would like to do something more. So the protocol is, whenever you have a case of pulmonary embolism, always like to scan in the of the pelvis to see for any thrombosis or in the extremity veins. So if you see here, This is a slide which we have taken. Always mandatory, whenever you suspect pulmonary embolism, always take limited cuts of the lower abdomen and pelvis to see for any source of embolism. So in this patient, luckily we found that there was a interluminal non-enhancing opacity in the left femoral vein. Can you see that?
Yes, sir.
That is the femoral artery which is homogeneous enhancing. If you see, this is not enhancing at all. So what could it be? This is to be a thrombus in the
femoral veins,
left common femoral vein, and this could be the source of the embolism in the pulmonary artery, right? Contributing to oligemic lung fields. Now I'm showing you a quiz regarding pulmonary embolism. If you can tell this, which is a just a quiz, what could this be in a case of pulmonary embolism?
So the density which we are seeing, infarction, pulmonary infarction distal to the obstructed segment.
Distal to the obstructed segment, pulmonary infarction. Can you describe this opacity?
So this is a lung window where we are seeing a homogeneous triangular shaped opacity in the peripherally placed lung fields, and with the base towards the pleura and the apex moving towards the hilum.
Okay. So what is this sign called? This is called the Hampton's hump sign. This is called the Hampton's hump sign. With Hampton's hump is classically seen in pulmonary embolism. It is specific for pulmonary embolism. Specific. Where you see a pleural based vesture opacity having his apex pointing towards the hilum. And what constitutes this opacity? It is the pleural based pulmonary infarcts. It's the pleural based pulmonary infarcts which contributed to this vest-shaped pleural opacity contributing to Hampton's hump. And whenever this melts away, after 3 to 4 weeks this melts away, and this leaves a linear opacity on the skygram called the plate eclectasia or the Fleischner's line. The skygram which we had shown you earlier, this is called the Fleischner's line, which is generally seen following the resolution of the Hampton's hump. Alright? So one thing which I like to keep in mind before I conclude the case one is, whenever you have a case of pulmonary embolism, you should always scan for the lower pelvis, for the lower abdomen and the pelvis to pick up the source of pulmonary embolism, and generally you may encounter embolism in the femoral veins. Finally, and lastly, before you make certainly a diagnosis of pulmonary embolism, always keep in mind that you could get superior findings of pulmonary embolism in such that the imaging scans which have taken, they are in the arterial phase of imaging, not in the venous phase, because the venous blood gets mixed with the pulmonary artery and gives a superior reading of a non-enhancing filling defect. So always keep in mind while imaging whether the scans have been taken arterial phase or the venous phase to confirm with certainty whether it is a spurious pulmonary embolism clot or a true pathological entity.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Rajiv, and thank you very much to Dr. Nitin and Dr. Bijender for a long case discussion in radiology. In this discussion, we have learned the long case of this pulmonary embolism and how to proceed. Means the way they are describing it, it has to be like PABU, then see the bony structure, airway, and lung parenchyma, and all these things. If you are in a line, the way Dr. Rajiv is telling, so I think you will not miss any things. And moreover, this only radiology is not complete enough to diagnose all this case. So sometimes you have to switch on in other diagnostic, like CT scan here, they describe the mediastinal window is very important. And besides this, also like scanning of the pelvis also give you very important information to diagnose a case. So here I would like to request all of you to ask the questions. Because this is the live interactive telecast, you can avail facility of this discussion. Whatever, if you have any doubts or if you want to know more, then please ask questions, and we will meet again after 15 minutes. And thank you very much to all.